So we were considering free energy, and now let's consider free energy that changes when reactions take place. So let's look at this. So chemical reactions or biochemical reactions can create changes in the free energy. And there we're looking at the delta as a change symbol. So the change in free energy now equals the change in enthalpy minus temperature delta S, the change in entropy. So you can see that delta G then, the free energy of the reaction, is dependent upon the relative values of the change in enthalpy and the change in entropy or disorder, and if we assume a constant temperature. And so delta G can be either positive or negative depending upon the relative values of delta H and T delta S. Now, obviously, if T delta S is greater than delta H, then delta G is negative. Whereas if T delta S is less than delta H, less than the change in enthalpy, then delta G is positive. And what does that mean in terms of whether reactions proceed or not? Let's consider that right now. So let's look at a reaction. Let's say that we have A plus B yields C plus D. These are the reactants and these are the products. So if the free energy G of the reactants is less than the free energy G of the products, that is, if the products contain more free energy than the reactants, then delta G is positive, because the change in delta, in the change in G in this case is positive, because the free energy of the products is greater than the free energy of the reactants. So the change in G was to go up. Another way to look at this, and we'll look at this again in a minute, but if we have energy here and the products contain more energy than the reactants, then in that case, delta G will be positive. The change in free energy is positive. Whereas, if we consider the reactants containing more free energy than the products, then we have the opposite case. We say that if we have A plus B yields C plus D, now if the reactants have more energy than the products, then G of the reactants is greater than the free energy of the products. In that case, we would have a graph that looked like this in the course of the reaction. We would have, here's energy, and here we would have the reactants, and there we would have the products. So in this case, the products have less energy than the reactants, and the change, therefore, in free energy is negative. There is a loss of free energy, if you will. And we're going to see the consequences of that for biochemical reactions shortly. So let's erase that and talk about the transfer of energy that occurs in biochemical reactions. So an endergonic reaction is a reaction that requires an input of energy in order for it to proceed. And that's when delta G is positive. And in terms of what we've just gone over, that makes good sense. So if we have the following case where delta G is positive, then we can look at the products have greater energy than the reactants. So there's a gain in energy. Delta G is positive, in other words. And in order to make that happen, we have to put energy into the system in order to raise the energy level of the system so that the end products have a higher energy state. So delta G then is positive. And those kind of reactions, when delta G is positive, those kind of reactions are not going to be spontaneous. They will not occur unless energy is put into them. So when delta G is positive, if you have a positive delta G, you do not have a spontaneous reaction. Not spontaneous. Whereas, if you have an exergonic reaction, a reaction that releases free energy, then we have the opposite case. There, delta G is negative. That is to say, this is our energy graph. Now, delta G is negative, we have a loss of free energy. So these are the products and these are the reactants. And the products have a lower energy than the reactants. Delta G is negative. And in that case, energy can be released because we're achieving a lower energy state. So, and in that case, delta G is negative. So when we have negative delta G, that implies then that we do have a spontaneous reaction. Because we achieve a lower energy state, which is thermodynamically favorable. All right. So here it is a little more neatly. In order to, if a biochemical reaction produces products that have a higher energy than the reactants, delta G is greater than zero, positive delta G. But if the reactants have more energy than the products, then we have a release of energy, delta G is less than zero. All right. So let's be a little more specific about this, try to get a little more intuitive about everything. Let's consider the following situation. We have delta G, we know it's negative. If delta G is negative, we have a spontaneous process that will release energy. Whereas if it's positive, we're going to have to put energy into it. It's a non-spontaneous reaction, we'll have to put energy into it in order for the reaction to occur. So whether delta G is negative or positive depends upon whether delta H is negative or positive, and whether delta S is negative or positive. And T is the temperature. So whether delta G is negative or positive depends upon whether the negativity and the positivity of delta H and delta S. And for our purposes, just remember this for this introductory superficial level, that delta H is positive, the change in enthalpy is positive if we are need to break chemical bonds in the process of the reaction. And remember that delta S is positive if the entropy increases, if disorder increases. Delta S is negative if order increases. That is, the entropy is negative. We have a loss of disorder and a gain of order. Keep those things in mind as we go through this briefly. So let's just do this rather superficially. And let's ask, we can predict whether a reaction is going to be spontaneous or not. We know that delta G needs to be negative, delta G needs to be negative for a reaction to be spontaneous. So let's see if a reaction is spontaneous, and let's look at delta H and delta S. So if delta H is less than zero, then delta H is a negative. And if delta S is a positive, it's greater than zero, then we have a negative minus a positive. And T is in degrees Kelvin, so it's always positive. So we have a negative minus a positive. And in that case, this then becomes a negative value, and it's a minus, minus, a minus, so delta G is negative. So if delta H is less than zero and delta S is greater than zero, then we have a negative minus a positive, we get even more negative. So here we have a negative delta G, and that will be spontaneous at any temperature. It's independent of temperature. But if delta H is greater than zero, so now we have a positive here, and delta S is less than zero, then we have minus T times a minus. S is minus in that case, S is negative. So it's a positive minus, going to be minus a negative number, which is really a positive, that turns into positive. So it's positive plus a value. So here, delta G is positive. We have a positive delta G. And that will be, it doesn't matter what temperature we're at, if we have a positive delta G, the reaction that we're talking about is not going to be spontaneous. Now let's talk about some cases down here where we have whether or not delta G is negative depends upon the relative values of the change in enthalpy and the change in entropy. So if delta H is less than zero, delta H is a negative. And if delta S is less than zero, then that would be minus a minus, which is really a positive. So it whether or not delta G is negative in that case depends upon the relative values of delta H and delta S. If delta S is very small relative to delta H, then a negative minus a minus would be plus a small value. So delta G might still be negative. And where T comes into play then is if T is large, that or I'm sorry, if T is very small, then we have negative minus a negative, which is a positive, and this value then is very small if T is low, so that delta G is still negative because delta H is negative. In other words, the value of delta H is greater than the value of T delta S. So delta G becomes negative then. So at low temperatures, we have a spontaneous reaction. Whereas at high temperatures, if H is greater than zero, so here, let's erase that. Now if we have H being positive and S is also positive, and we have minus T times a positive. So depending on, the relative values of T delta S, that will determine whether delta G is negative or positive. And if T is very high, then it'll be a positive minus a large number, and that could bring delta G into negative territory. So delta G would become negative if T is very high. So in this case, if H is greater than zero and S is greater than zero, we will have spontaneous reaction, but only at high temperatures, not at low temperatures. So the key thing here is just to remember that whether delta G is negative or positive depends upon these factors. And we can get into situations where temperature will come into play in terms of determining whether a reaction is positive, whether the delta G for a reaction is positive or negative. And a great case to think about is, let's say, melting ice. And we'll talk about that in class. All right, now let's talk about one more thing before we move on to the energy currency of the cell and enzymes. And that is that even spontaneous reactions with negative delta Gs might take activation energy to get started. That is, a little extra energy needs to be put into the system to get a reaction started, even though the products have a lower energy than the reactants. And that activation energy you can think of as destabilizing existing chemical bonds or bringing components into close proximity so that reactions can take place. And so even for exergonic reactions, as I've said, even when delta G is negative or when energy is released by a reaction and the reaction would be spontaneous, activation energies sometimes have to be put in to get the whole process started. Excuse me again. And what catalysts are substances that lower the activation energy of a reaction so that the reaction can proceed more quickly. That's what catalysts do. And in biochemistry, catalysts are usually enzymes. They're protein enzymes that make for a lower activation energy to get things started. So if we have reactants and products here, an exergonic reaction, here would be the activation energy without a catalyst. But here's the activation energy with a catalyst. So what the enzyme catalysts do is lower the activation energy so as to speed up the process of a biochemical reaction, even one that it has a negative delta G. And we'll pick up with the next part with ATP.